All right, grab your Bible and open it to Ephesians chapter 2, please. Ephesians chapter 2. I'll start reading in verse 4 in just a few minutes. So I've started riding a road bike for exercise. I've been doing it since about December of last year. And there's two ways you can ride a road bike. There's two different things you can put on your foot. For the last 6 months, I've been riding with my running shoes on. This makes sense to me, and I'll show you why in a second, because the other option is called a cleat. And what you do with these is you actually clip in to your pedals. You lock your shoes to the pedals of your bike. Stupid people wear these, all right? It's crazy, absolutely crazy, right? In fact, a few weeks ago, I was riding at White Rock Lake early in the morning, and I came flying around a corner. And as I was coming around the corner, too close for me to stop was a fairly large water moccasin, a big black cottonmouth just slithering across the path, right? So I've got a choice. I can go on the head side, or I can go on the tail side. I veered for the tail side. But as I was going by, the snake stopped, sensed me coming, coiled back, and as I was going by, struck out at me. I picked up my foot, it went right under my foot, and as I was riding away, my first thought was, I'm so glad I was not clipped in. If I would have been clipped in, the snake would have got me on my ankle, and I would be dead now. These are extraordinarily dangerous things, these shoes. Very, very dangerous. So I was quite happy just riding in my running shoes. And then a friend of mine called me a few weeks ago and invited me to go on one of these group rides. Have you seen these big groups of people riding their bikes down the road on Saturday morning and stuff? And he asked me to go and do that, and I just imagined myself being the poor person way in the back. Have you ever seen that? Just trying to catch up to everyone. I'm like, but I can try this. I can do this. And then he texted me. He said, hey, Pete, just wondering, are you still riding in your running shoes? And I wrote back, and I'm like, yeah, why? Well, just wondering. Some of these riders can be a little snobby, and they'll probably look down on you, just saying. So I went out and bought some cleats. But I bought a special kind of cleats. These cleats, you can see the cleat part of these shoes is recessed. And on my pedals, there's two sides. On one side, you can clip in and get all locked into your pedals. Or if you flip the pedal over, it's just like a normal pedal, and you can just ride like this, right? So here's what I did. I went and bought these cleats, and I pretended to be clipped in. I'm riding down the bike with all these like professional riders, right? I'm riding down the road, and every time we come to a stop line or stop sign, they all stop, and then this is the way you click out. You throw your heel out, and then you pull out like this. And they're all throwing their heels out, and so I get to the stop sign, and I'm like, and we start up again, and I'm like pretending to click in every time we come to a stop sign. So I'm telling my daughter, Annika, about this, and she's just like, Dad, that's pathetic. Which, of course, it is. Pretending is pathetic. I was pretending to be someone I'm not. Why would I do such a thing? I've never met these people before. I'll probably never see them again. I was captured in this thing called perception management. It's a phenomenon many of us experience. John Ortberg was the first one that brought it to my attention in one of his books. And he talked about the fact that there are these Siskels and Eberts in our life. Remember Siskel and Ebert? They both died, actually, but they were film critics, and they would have a TV show, and they'd show a movie, and they'd describe it, and then at the end, they'd either give it a thumbs up or a thumbs down. And if you got two thumbs up, that was like on all the newspaper clippings, right? This movie got two thumbs up, and everyone went to the two thumbs up. And we look at those important people in our life, the people that we really care about, and if they give us a thumbs up, then we feel better about ourselves. Ortberg shares this example. He said, years ago, I was at a pastor's conference. During a break between sessions, three of us were talking together. One man said to another, so how's your church doing? In case you're not a pastor, let me translate. That's a pastorese for, so how big is your church? Which is pastorese for, so how important are you? Are you worthwhile for me to get to talk to and get to know? And would it be cool to go back home and tell people in my congregation that I had a conversation with you? The pastor responded, oh, pretty good. We have about 1,000 at our church. How's your church doing? The next pastor said, well, the Lord's really blessing us. We have 1,500 in attendance at our church. And then they looked at me. I knew what was coming next. I was working at a church that had maybe 250 attendees at the time. And this little voice, so quiet I could barely even hear it, began to whisper some perception management strategies into my ear. Say the church has about 300 people. 250 people is awfully small. A church of 300 people sounds less embarrassing than 250. Right at the same time, another little voice responded, what are you doing? You don't even know these guys. You'll never see them again. Do you think they really care? Are you willing to trade in your integrity for the sake of the status that you would gain by 50 lousy people? So I said, yeah, we run around 2,000. He's pretending. He's pretending. Why would he do such a thing? Why would we pretend? You ever pretend? You drive a nicer car than you can really afford, so people think you're actually more successful than you are. It's pretending. Do you brag and exaggerate about your minor successes? By the way, we usually do this on Twitter and Facebook. When was the last time you posted something on one of those two social media outlets that was negative about you? We're pretending. Do you live vicariously through your kids? Tell everyone about how great they're doing because they're actually doing better than you ever thought you would do? It's pretending. Pretending is exhausting because it's like lying. You know what happens when you lie? Then for the rest of your life, you got to cover up that lie. It's exhausting, right? And pretending actually is lying. You're lying about who you really are. I am a running shoe rider. I was pretending to be a clip-in rider. It's a lie. I want them to think I'm someone I'm not actually. Why do we do this? And there's a lot of reasons why we do it. I think one primary reason that we do it is because we are convinced that our lives are less impressive than they ought to be. They're less impressive than they should be. Are you disappointed in yourself? Do you find yourself thinking, you know what, I should be farther along by now? Should have done more, should have accomplished more. Kind of wish I had. This is an identity issue, actually, because pretense, pretending, is the result of seeking identity in the perception of others. And pretense is eliminated when we can start to believe the truth about ourselves. What would you say if I told you that you are far from unimpressive in God's eyes? You are. And I'm about to read a passage of scripture that if you will grab a hold of this truth, if you will truly believe it, listen to me, you'll never have to pretend again. Whew. Pretense, a thing of the past. Free from pretending. Doesn't that sound awesome? Let's dive into this text together. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 4. You know what? Stand with me. Let's honor God's word and stand as I read this text to you. It is one of the great New Testament passages about salvation and about how God works so diligently to rescue us. Okay? But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, has made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms, in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. Why did God go out of his way to save you? Because he's got all this kindness wrapped up in grace that he's longing to show you. That's why. For it is by grace. Have you noticed how many times the word grace has appeared in this one little text? God's unmerited favor, God's undeserved kindness. It is by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not from yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works. You don't do this. He does this so that no one can boast. And here's the verse we're going to look at, verse 10. For we are God's workmanship created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Isn't that a beautiful text? Go ahead and have a seat. We only have time to dive into one little portion of the text this morning. The beginning of verse 10. Listen to these words. For we are God's workmanship created in Christ Jesus. This is the truth that if you can grasp it, will set you free from pretending. Let me unwrap it for you. He starts with for we, not just me, not just you, but we. He's speaking to all true believers here. The context is obviously people who have passed from death to life, true believers, people who have said yes to Jesus, had their sins washed away, have Jesus living inside them and are now walking in him. We, individually, every single one of us, and we corporately, the church, are God's workmanship. Circle that word workmanship. It's a fantastic word. It means a couple things. First of all, I want to point out that it is God's work, that he is the worker. My Christian identity is his job to create. It's his work. We don't make ourselves, we don't save ourselves. There is this tendency for us to think of God incorrectly as passively sitting by watching. But our God is an extraordinarily active God. He is engaged. He was engaged at the very beginning. In the beginning, God created. Whoa, that's active. That's engagement. First thing we learn about him is that he created the universe. Woo, big action there. He then created mankind. And then mankind sinned and fell from him. And now he has been chasing us, reaching out to us, initiating. That's a very active thing. He gave the law to the people of Israel. He gave kings to the people of Israel. He gave prophets to the people of Israel. He was active in all these things. And at the right time, he sent his son. That was an active thing to do. And at just the right time, that son, fully God and fully man, voluntarily sacrificed himself on the cross and did the work of salvation there. And then God actively raised him from the dead, and God actively brought him back into heaven, and God actively sent the Holy Spirit so that we could receive the Spirit and be given new life and to be made into new creations. This is all his work. And the reason you think you're less than impressive, follow me, the reason you think you're less than impressive is because you're focused on your work. But if you can start to shift your focus onto his work, you'll stop thinking that way. You know why? Because his work is extraordinarily impressive. Extraordinarily so. For we, you and me, we are God's work, and we are also his workmanship. The word workmanship in the original language is poema. It's the word from which we get poem. It's an artistic word. It denotes a work of art. It denotes a masterpiece. It's translated that way in different places in Greek literature. A poem, a work of art, a masterpiece. And the person who creates a poema is called a poetes, a poet. And what this text is communicating to us is that God is a poet. He is the great poet, and he has created in you a poem. You are a masterpiece. You are a poem. We are created in Christ Jesus. The word created means to make something out of nothing. It's a word that's used exclusively of God's activity in Scripture. This word is never used for some person working. This is God's work. He does this. He creates us. He creates a poem called you. And it's a masterpiece. The word created is in the aorist tense, which means it happened at a point in time, sometime in the past. It's in the passive mood, which means it happens to us. It's not something we do for ourselves. You see how much initiative on God's part there is in this text? He's the one doing this. And at some point in time, the moment we said yes to Jesus, he creates in us a poem. He recreates us as a poem, as a masterpiece. This is one thing you remember from this message today. Remember this. You are God's beautiful poem. Not just you, I am too. You are God's beautiful poem, and so am I. Remember that. Some of you think, you know what, I'm really very unimpressive. The reason you're thinking that is because you're focused on your work. What this text tells us is the greatest artist in the universe considers you his masterpiece. Can I say that again? Listen to me. The greatest artist in the universe considers you to be his masterpiece. Some of you are having a hard time buying this. This word, poema, appears only one other place in the New Testament. I want you to turn there. It's in Romans chapter 1, verse 20. Romans chapter 1, verse 20. In Romans chapter 1, the Apostle Paul is arguing that God's wrath is coming on mankind, and God is justified in bringing it forth because in the act of creation and in what creation is, God has communicated enough of who he is that people can be held accountable. And this is the way he says it in Romans chapter 1, verse 20. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, God has a lot of invisible qualities, God's invisible qualities, two are listed here, his eternal power and his divine nature. Divine nature kind of encompasses all of his invisible qualities. Since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, his divine, his eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen. So his invisible qualities are clearly seen. How is that possible? Being understood from what has been made so that people are without excuse. Underline those words, what has been made. Those four words in English, one word in Greek, poema. How do God's invisible qualities make themselves known to people? Through his poem called creation, through his masterpiece called creation. So we are hiking in Canada one day and we come around the corner and we see something like this. Ah, that's pretty. And as we're looking at the lake and we're looking up at the mountain, whenever I see a mountain like that, my first thought is, you know, one day God said, mountain, there, and it happened. That's power. Can I just say, that's power. Every time I look at one of those things and I realize that God put it into place with his word, I am amazed at the almighty power of our God. And every once in a while, this happens. Aren't Texas thunderstorms the best? I mean, they just roll through town, right? And the thunder just gets louder and louder, and it starts to shake the house, and all our dogs run into the closet. Do your dogs run into the closet? Our dogs run into the closet. Off they go. And the house is shaking. You can feel it rumbling, and you just feel the almighty power of God. And one day you have a vacation at the beach and you're standing right on the shoreline and the water's lapping on your toes and the waves are coming in and you feel the concussion of the waves when they crash on. You can feel it. And one after another remind us of the power of our God. And you just look at creation and in creation there is enough to know of who he is. Listen to me. God calls two things his poem. God wrote two poems. Ready? Number one, creation. Number two, you. And what's stunning is that in both of his poems, he demonstrates his almighty power and his divine nature. Oh, perish the thought that you would think yourself unimpressive. You are a poetic masterpiece created by God himself. There's only two of them, creation and you. Isn't that beautiful? That's truth, friends. I'm preaching truth here. You are God's beautiful poem, and so am I. And you might be thinking, well, okay, it's right there in the Bible. I'm his poem, so I'll agree with you. I'm his poem. But there's beautiful poems, and then there's just bad poems. And that's true. There are bad poems. I'll give you an example. This is a birthday haiku. I got it off a webpage of the 100 worst short poems. This is number 76. It goes like this. Today is birthday. Tomorrow is not birthday. Refrigerator. That's bad poetry right there. There are beautiful poems, there are bad poems. The Old Testament that we have in our Bible was written originally in Hebrew. Most of it was written in Hebrew. But then before Jesus was born, it was translated by a group of scholars into Greek. And that Greek translation of the Old Testament is called the Septuagint. And many of our New Testament writers, they relied on the Septuagint. They looked at the Greek of the Old Testament as they were writing books to us. And so many of their quotes are from the Septuagint. And there are two places in the Septuagint where the word poema appears. One of them is in Ecclesiastes. Listen to this verse. Ecclesiastes 3:11 says, "All the things which he has made are beautiful. All the things which he has made is the verb form of poema. All the poems that he has made are, say it with me, beautiful. Beautiful. So if you are his poem, he only makes one kind, beautiful ones. I think it's been said this way, God don't make no junk. Think about it. He's the most creative person in the universe. He is perfectly creative. At some point, he sat down to create you. And as he created you, as he recreated you in Christ, he created you as a work of art. And as he presents this work of art to the world, his thought is, wow, that's beautiful. Wow, that's beautiful. You're God's beautiful poem, and so am I. We are. There's a movie coming out. It's called Boyhood. I have not seen it. I am not recommending it. I'm mesmerized by it. The reason I'm mesmerized by it is because I've read about it and I've watched the trailer. It's the fictional story about a boy named Mason, and it follows his life from the first grade through when he departs for college, so 12 years or so. The unique thing about this movie is in the way in which it was made. This movie was filmed over a 12-year period. So every year, for 3 or 4 days, the crew and the cast would come together. They would film like 13 different scenes, and then wait a year, come back, and film 13 more. And so as you're watching this 2.5-hour-long movie, as you're watching the movie, the actors are actually aging as they go through life. This is an amazing concept. The producer of this movie, his name is Richard Linklater. He's a Texan, actually, lives down in Austin. He got this creative idea about 15 years ago. He figured out how to do it. And over the last 12 years, he's created this beautiful piece of art. And he's giving it to the world for us to enjoy. And by all indications, it is a poema. It's a masterpiece. It sucks you into the story unlike any other movie you've ever been to. It's uniquely beautiful, apparently. At the end of the trailer, there's a black screen, and on the black screen, these one-word reviews pop up from newspapers all over the country. I'm going to share the words with you. Transporting, soulful, beautiful, dazzling, astonishing, extraordinary, exhilarating, spellbinding. These are words appropriate for a beautiful masterpiece, for a work of art, for someone's poem. I'm going to ask you to do something. It's going to be a little uncomfortable. Go ahead and stand up for me. Some of you are having a hard time believing that you are his beautiful poem. And so I'm going to give you an exercise that will help you start to think and own this. I'm going to say something, and I want you, if you believe it, if you're in Christ and you believe this, I want you to say it after me. I want you to repeat it like you really mean it, out loud. Told you, it's going to be a little awkward. But you can do it. Let's just start with this. I am God's beautiful poem. Say it.
I am God's beautiful poem.
You are, you know. No, don't say that. All right. Say it again. I am God's beautiful poem.
I am God's beautiful poem.
I am transporting.
I am transporting.
I in Christ am soulful.
In Christ, I am
beautiful.
In Christ, I am
dazzling.
You are,
you're dazzling in Christ. In Christ, I am astonishing.
In Christ, I am
extraordinary.
In Christ, I am
exhilarating.
In Christ, I am spellbinding.
Go ahead and have a seat. Some of you are like, this is so weird. The reason you're struggling with this, the reason this feels unnatural to you is because you have bought the lie that your worth is found in your performance, that it is your work that determines how impressive you are. The fact of the matter is that it is His work that determines how impressive you are. And His work is magnificent. Can you see how if you just own this, you don't have to pretend anymore? What's the point? You're His beautiful poem. And so am I. There's one other place in the Septuagint where this word appears. And it's a text that is specifically for those of you who are sitting there saying, I still don't buy this. Because I'll buy that I'm a poem, and I'll believe you that I'm beautiful, even though I don't believe that I really am. I'm struggling with that. Because I look at other people, and I see other people, and they look beautiful. They're beautiful people. Their personalities are just so spectacular, and the way they interact with people, and I'm so plain, and I'm so boring, and God could have done better with me, we think. Well, this text is for you. It's in Isaiah 29, verse 16. God says, but when you're thinking that way, you're turning things upside down as if the potter were thought to be like clay. So, in other words, for you to say to God, you could have done better with me, is kind of like the pot telling the potter he blew it. That's what he says next. Shall what is formed say to the one who formed it, you did not make me? Can the pot say to the potter, you know nothing? A word poema appears three times in this text. Shall what is formed, the poem, poema, shall the poem say to the one who formed it, poetes, poet, you did not poet me? Shall the poem say to the poet, you didn't poet me? Shall the poem say to the poet, you know what? You don't know enough to create me right. It's a rhetorical question. Of course, the answer is absolutely not. Absolutely. Could you imagine the sculptor, you know, David, the sculptor David that Michelangelo made? Can you imagine the sculptor saying to Michelangelo, right as Michelangelo saying, finishing touches. Can you imagine the sculptor saying, hey, Michelangelo, how about a fig leaf or something? You have to know the statue to know what I'm referring to there. Can you imagine the Mona Lisa saying to Da Vinci, can you take a little off my nose right here? Can you imagine Juliet saying to Shakespeare, wherefore art thou, really, can I just say, where are you? No, the character does not tell the poet how to write the story. The painting does not tell the painter how to create the face. The sculpture does not tell the sculptor what to add or what to subtract. The artist is the artist. The piece of art, listen, the piece of art, the role of the piece of art is to receive the creative genius placed in it and rest there. Friends, the master of the universe has created genius in you, in Christ. That is the truth. Rest there. Believe it. Holy Spirit, I pray in this moment right now you would reveal it to us. That this is true, straight out of your word. That we are your beautiful poem. If you will believe this, it has implications in two areas, how we view ourselves and how we view others, right? If you believe your truth, that you are His beautiful poem, then you can no longer think of yourself as less than impressive. So the next time your ex-spouse ridicules you, you can pray, Holy Spirit, remind me that I am His beautiful poem. Let me rest there. The next time classmates make fun of a physical attribute of yours, whatever it may be, I know it hurts. I know it does. We've all experienced that. But you can go to the Lord and you say, Holy Spirit, remind me that in God's eyes, I'm a beautiful poem. The next time they call your names or laugh in your face or reject you, Holy Spirit, remind me, beautiful poem. The next time you're tempted to pretend, the next time you're tempted to pretend you're someone you're not. Holy Spirit, remind me There's no reason to pretend. What that person thinks about me is completely irrelevant because the master artist of the universe created me as a masterpiece. Whew, that's all that matters. I don't need to pretend anymore. This changes the way I view my siblings in Christ, too. Do you remember that class you took in high school that sounded like a blow-off class, but you found out it wasn't? The art appreciation class, remember that one? Like, I thought I appreciated art till I took this class, and not so much anymore. You know what the church is? The church is an opportunity for art appreciation. When we're interacting with our brothers and sisters in Christ, we are not comparing impressiveness. Listen to me. We are not comparing how impressive one person is compared to someone else. It's not what we do when we come together. Instead, we are appreciating God's artistry. What a beautiful poem you are. What a beautiful poem you are. What a crazy poem you are. What a fascinating poem you are. You know, a few years back, Libby and I had the opportunity to spend an evening with our special needs ministry. We have a robust special needs ministry here at Bentry. You know why? Because we do not see special needs children and adults as problems. We see them as poems. All right? Unique, creative, magnificent, one-of-a-kind poems. In the first portion of our evening with them, we spent with the parents, and we heard about the struggles and the strains and how difficult it is to raise these kids that have so many needs. And then at the end, all the kids came in and talk about energy filling the room. Dozens of them filling the room, all with different special needs. And I remember meeting one little girl. She was about this tall at the time. She literally looked like a princess from a Disney movie. Long, flowing blonde hair. Beautiful little pink dress she was wearing. She has autism. And to my knowledge, even to this day, she's never spoken a word. But each night, her mother would sing hymns and praise choruses to her. And a couple years ago, as the mother was singing to her, she started to sing along. All the words known from memory. The next night, she sang again. The next night, she sang again. And she goes about her life singing. She is a singing poem. She may be the only one on the planet. How spectacular is that? How beautiful is that? There's another boy, an autistic boy. He doesn't sing. He's full of energy. He's full of passion. When he walked in the room, you could feel him. And you looked in his eyes and they were darting around, and he is a magnetic personality. He is a passionate poem. And his parents are worn out. But what a beautiful, spectacular poem he is. There's another little girl. I believe she has cerebral palsy, but I'm not sure. But she's in a wheelchair. She has great physical struggles. And I remember just starting to interact with her. And I started interacting with her, and she started giving me grief. I'm like, what are you doing? She's like coming back at me. She's making fun of me. She's picking on my haircut. And I started going back and forth with her, and I realized this is a sassy poem. That's what this is. She is a sassy poem. And every time I've had interaction with her, she's sassy. There's a sassiness about her that's beautiful. Absolutely beautiful. You know what happens when you start to believe this? Like, really believe it? You start to look at your brothers and sisters not as problems, but as poems. As we come together, we enjoy art appreciation time. Because the greatest poet in the universe created each of us. And it's beautiful. In 1989, Robin Williams starred in a remarkable film entitled The Dead Poets Society. You remember it, some of you? And he tried to get high school students to fall in love with the poetry, human poetry. And much human poetry is lovely and powerful and dynamic, but it is all finite and limited because every poet that has ever written either is dead or will be one day. It's the one thing they all have in common. They are finite people. What's beautiful about the church is that we are the living poets society. Our poet is still alive. He's still writing poetry. Some of you became poems this last week as you trusted Christ. He's still writing poetry. We are the living poets society. And one of the great joys of being part of a local body of believers is we get to hear the stories and the poetry as we share life together. Please stand with me. I want to pray over you and send you on your way. Lord, my prayer for my people is that we would believe this to be true, that we would rest in the fact that because of your work and because of your workmanship, because of your artistic genius, you have created each of us in Christ beautifully. We'd stop trying to pretend we're someone we're not. And as we live in that robust freedom, people will be attracted to the freedom. People will be attracted to the authenticity. People will be attracted to you. Lord Jesus, do this in us, we pray. And all God's people said, amen. Amen.